coming, spending your Saturdays.
Thank you.
With some good information, and we're gonna do probably about an hour of like a slideshow presentation on Genoa, and then after that, we'll have lunch, and then we'll do a live auto skip on the tank after.
That'd be fun.
Yeah, that'd be fun. Hi, my name is JBJ Aquarium Products. JBJ has been around since 1995. Mainly products geared towards marine saltwater aquariums, and about 3-4 years ago, we partnered with Genoa. And they're a German company that they focus strictly on freshwater climate tanks and freshwater shrimp and all that good stuff. And Matthias is from Genoa. He flew out from the Netherlands to do this workshop. So,
keep building up the pressure.
Yeah. No pressure at all. But yeah, I'm going to pass it on to Matthias.
Help people find a seat.
Yeah.
Welcome to you all. As many said, I'm from Genoa. My name is Matthijs. I'm going to give a slide presentation about who is Genoa. A lot of people won't know our company, based mainly in Europe. We exist from the 1966 already, and we're all about freshwater planted aquariums and how to run a good functioning freshwater planted aquarium. We're Genoa. We like to be cool, modern, with a certain kind of lifestyle. We're into the hobby, and we're for the whole family. We're there for the kids, as for the senior people. Denneler was founded in 1966 by Ludwig Denneler. He sadly died in 2006, but this guy was a big one in planted aquariums. And in the 60s, he could only do his tanks with the plants that are available at that time in Europe. He read a lot about it, knew that was way more plants than we could find at that moment in Europe. So he went out to South America on a holiday with his wife, started going into nature, into the jungle, and collected all different kinds of species of plants that he'd never seen before. Took them home with him. At that time, it was still allowed. Tried to grow them in his own tanks, and they all died after a few weeks. And he was thinking, why? I'm already long into the hobby. I can set up the most beautiful tanks with the plants I can find in Europe, but why aren't those plants growing into my tanks? Year after he went back, he took a friend, a biologist, and they start looking at the environment. They start looking at the ground, what's in it, the water conditions, the light that comes into the whole atmosphere that was there. We founded in 1966. We have 170 employees working. We have two locations in Germany, one greenhouse and one office. And then in Sri Lanka, we have our biggest greenhouse, and in total, we combine our greenhouses with about 110,000 square meters of greenhouses. On an average day in our company, 30,000 plants leave our company to go all over the world to the shops and to the end consumer to build up beautiful aquariums. The markets that we're in are mainly in Europe, but the last 4 years, we're expanding more and more over the world because we've got a new species of plants. It's called in vitro. It's tissue cultured plants, and that makes it able to ship out plants all over the world. This is a picture of our greenhouses in Germany. As you can see, we have some bad weather conditions there in wintertime, so we have to work very hard to keep everything hot and nice climate for the plants. The lights are all specially made for the plants there. You start the photosynthetic process already into our greenhouses. We do a lot of echinoderms, Tour plant. It's one of our most beloved plants. We got more than 50 species of this plant. Of course, we have to build our tropical climate in our greenhouses. In Sri Lanka, it's easier because the temperature there is much friendlier. But there also, we try to control the climate as much as we can by blocking out too much sunlight onto the plants. How the hobby started in Europe? The first written article goes back to the 1800s. It was a guy from Austria, Emil Rosenmassler. He's the first one who has written about a freshwater planted aquarium. In those days, they had different shapes and forms than we're used to at this moment. But that's where it all started. The first clubs appeared in Europe in the 70s. More and more equipment became available for the plants, so it got easier into the hobby. Books, catalogs appeared. Our first catalog came out in the 70s. All written by Ludwig Dedeler about aquarium plants, about substrate, about fertilization for your plants. If you have questions, just ask them in between. And all our products, the plants, but also the nutrition, also everything that we make for the plants, all based on Mother Nature. It's all biological. We don't work with any chemicals. Our whole philosophy runs on Mother Nature. How does Mother Nature run her tanks in the wild? Because what we have learned in those 50 years that we're there, that Mother Nature is never wrong. If the circumstances are not right in nature to grow plants, plants will not grow there. What we are doing in our freshwater tanks, we want to decide where we put our plants. We want to decide how it's going to look. By doing that, we have to make sure that we follow all the rules of Mother Nature, so that we make sure that the plant gets everything that it needs to fully grow. If you look in nature where plants be found, there's a high nutrition in the ground. There's a good bacterial environment that makes it possible for the plants to take in the nutrition. There's enough light coming in. There's a high amount of CO2 by rotted plant leaves, by wood rotting into the substrate coming up, so the plants can find the CO2 to proceed the photosynthetic process. And water change. There's a constant water change going on in nature where plants grow. So too much nutrition is always away again. With that knowledge, we build in the five element system. And with those five elements, we will follow the rules of Mother Nature. It starts with the aquarium bed, enough plants in your bed, the good light above your aquarium, the water conditions, and the animals. If that's all in balance, you have a good functioning aquarium. Your water is going to be clear, your plants will be growing good, and your fish and your shrimps will be happy and healthy. This is written out, the balance in your aquarium. All those elements are in contact with each other. You cannot leave one behind and expect your aquarium to function. If we change one of those elements in your aquarium, it will infect everything else. By knowing that, we should be careful what we do in our aquarium. This balance appears after 6 months doing everything right into your aquarium. Those first 6 months are very important in a freshwater aquarium, because then everything is going to set and tries to find the balance in your aquarium. That's why you have to help Mother Nature. Once that balance is found in your aquarium, it gets easier. So that's why we made the check system. buy a check system, it gives you guidance, it gives you an overview, what you're doing in your aquarium, it will give you the knowledge, what's happening in your aquarium, when algae appear, why do they appear in your aquarium, and it's going to give you safety, because you know what path you have to follow to get to that end result. And at last, we all want to have fun with our aquarium. This is a nice picture of a Dutch style aquarium. This guy is called Rick Verhulst. He's a Dutch guy, like me. He won the prize in 2015 with his built aquarium. He only used Danone products. We're very proud of him, we sponsored him a lot, but this is what's possible if you put your time and effort into it. The balance in your planted aquarium, because food comes into the fish. The waste comes out of the fish. The fish will produce CO2 for your plants. Light and the CO2 will bring the photosynthetic process going on in the aquarium. They will get the nutrition from the aquarium bed. The fertilizer for the leaves of the plant, and your plant will start producing the oxygen, and the oxygen is there for your fish and for your shrimps. If your plants are doing well in your aquarium, you have no need for an extra oxygen pump coming into your aquarium. But too much oxygen will disrupt your balance in your aquarium. The CO2 produced by fish is never enough for your plants to grow well. So you always have to have an extra source of CO2 coming into your aquarium. What do the plants give you in return? Less algae, because the plant and the algae, they're both green cells, meaning they'll eat the same. But a plant is much stronger than the algae. An algae is easy. It can go on one nutrition source, mean light. It can appear quickly. But if you start feeding your plants and giving the right amount of light into your aquarium, the plants will always win it from the algae. More plants mean more oxygen for your fish. Healthier fish, reduce the waste in your aquarium, because we start feeding our fish a lot, much more than the fish need. Fish never die from hunger, fish they die from us polluting the water. If we look in nature, fish has to find its food. There may be some days that he doesn't eat at all. And what we're doing is, it's always nice if we shut all the food above the aquarium, all the fish come out, and it's fun to feed them. But the more food comes into the fish, the more waste comes out of the fish. And that's disrupting the balance again in your aquarium. And plants that you put in an aquarium, you got a nice piece of nature in your living room. The aquarium bed, why is it necessary? The plants get a good root system out of it. The nutrition that comes from the aquarium bed is necessary for the plant to survive on the water. Microorganisms will cover the whole ground floor. And we have two different ways of setting up a root system, an aquarium bed for your aquarium. That's the classic way. It's a two-layer system. It's a substrate and gravel. The nutrition inside of the substrate is only taken up by plants through the root system. So if we don't cover it up with gravel, it's going to float into the water. Plants have no use for it because they cannot take it in anymore. And the algae in your aquarium, they will eat it and they will grow very bigly in the aquarium. So 1 inch to 2 inch of substrate and covered a 1 or 2 inches of gravel to make sure that it stays there where it needs to be. An advantage of the classic way is that the substrate and gravel will last up for many years. With the Danelin substrate, it can go up to 7 years. So you can build your aquarium and enjoy it for a very, very long time. And with gravel, you can choose many colors. We don't recommend the pink, the yellow, the blue ones. It's not a natural color. Fish are always food animals in nature, so they're stressful. They like to be on a dark surface so they can be more relaxed, that they don't be seen by bigger fish. Then there's the modern way, and that's a single layer. It's substrate and gravel in one. It's called soil, it's baked lava. It's a 2-in-1 product. It only lasts up for 2 years. I will pass the soil around. You can feel it, touch it. It's double baked lava dirt. It's full of nutrition. The grain is slightly hard because it's twice baked, so it will last up for 2 years. But after 2 years in the water, it will turn back into dust. And then if you start doing something in your aquarium, you get a dust cloud appearing in your aquarium, and you have to take your plants out. If you wash them carefully, your stones, wash them carefully, you can put them back in with new soil. But after 2 years, that's done. And it's only available at this moment in one color, and that's black. We're working on other colors. We're trying gray and brown at the moment, but baking that twice, either the color goes away or it still is too soft to handle. Soil has another advantage: it will interact with your water. While the substrate and the gravel are water neutral, so your pH level doesn't go down, with soil, your pH level will drop in 2 days to approximately 5.86. That's nice. Fish and shrimps love it. Certain kinds are shrimps that need a higher pH level. But algae have very hard time to grow above the pH level, or below the pH level from 7. So as long as you keep your pH level below the 7, you've got an excellent barrier for the algae not to appear in your aquarium. We deliver our substrate in buckets. It contains sand, wood, clay, leaves, everything that you can find in the jungle on places where aquarium plants grow. If you open a bucket, you smell the richness of the ground. You smell it like it's an autumn day in the woods. But it has one disadvantage: it always has to be covered with gravel. With soil, you're ready to go. So we got the substrate for every kind of customer. If you want a Dutch style aquarium and you put a lot of work inside of it, you want to enjoy it for a long time. So then the safest way is to go with the gravel and the substrate, so you don't have to redo your aquarium after 2 years. But with aquascaping, what we are going to do later on the aquarium, the fun of aquascaping is building the picture, what you have in your head about something you've seen in the woods, something you've seen somewhere on a movie, the Rocky Mountains. That's the picture that you want to build into your aquarium. After the aquarium is set and all your plants have been growing as you want them to grow, they're done. And then you have a new picture already in your head to make a new tank. So if you do aquascaping, is soil is the easy way to go, because it immediately kicks off You can start right away, and after 2 years, get everything out, go to the shop, buy some new rocks, buy some new woods. There will be some new plants available at that time. Get them into the aquarium and start building a whole new picture. Natural bait lava. Then we have the shrimp soil. It's basically similar to the normal scaper soil, but it's got extra vitamins and nutrition for shrimps inside. That's the only difference. They both support plant growth. They both can be beautiful with freshwater shrimps inside, but this one is specially made for freshwater shrimps. Also lasts only for 2 years. And then it will turn back into dust, and you have to redo it. And this one also brings your pH level down to 6. If you already have an aquarium and you don't have the substrate in your aquarium and you have problems with plants growing, we have a nice root fertilization that has all the nutrition inside for the plants to start growing. With those nutrient balls, with each plant that you plant into your aquarium, you put 3 balls, stick them with the roots of the plants. They will last up for 6 months, and they will substitute your substrate. It's nothing that we recommend, because we always want a substrate based into your aquarium. If you already set up an aquarium or you have a substrate that isn't doing well anymore in your aquarium, you can help your plants with it. Maybe you've got a corner in your aquarium where not all the nutrition is flowing to, and you see that plants have problems growing at that spot, and you pick the dead plants out, go to the shop, buy a new plant. Going back home to your aquarium, and a new plant you will put back into the grave of the other plant, hoping that it will grow there at that moment, not without a little help. With those nutrient balls, you'll be sure that everything you need through the root system is there. And after 6 months, you redo it. This is the control picture been taken in our head office. This is the normal plant. With one tap, you get a similar result. With 2 taps, you see a way bigger plant. And with 3 taps, you're getting mother plants. You're growing mother plants in your aquarium. This is a picture taken in Germany, Lauburn. It's Byron, near to the Italian border. And this is a beautiful picture of Mother Nature being in balance. Crystal clear water, a lot of plants growing inside. And even in the cold conditions that we have over there, it's functioning. This picture is taken in the afternoon. And you see all those air bubbles saying the plant is happy. The photosynthetic process is going on, meaning there's a high amount of CO2 in the water. There's enough light coming into the water for the plants to start getting into action. I like this picture from Brazil very much, because this is a small river, and here we got plants. Here plants are growing into a group, and in between there grows nothing. And why are those plants growing there and not over there?
You want to turn off the lights? Or
for me it's okay, but...
Can everyone see that? Or
yeah.
Turn the lights down, please.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
Much better. Okay. So here are plants growing. Here are plants growing. And in between, there's nothing growing. Meaning, there is a lack of nutrition on those places. And Mother Nature is easy. If it cannot grow there, it will not grow there. a lot of different kind of aquarium plants. At this moment there are known 260 species of aquarium plants, not all available in the shops, not even with us. We carry about 220 aquarium plants every week. But even for us, some plants are too hard to grow in the greenhouses, and the demand is not enough to make it commercial on those plants. So why do we need the aquarium plants into our aquarium? They bring in the healthy condition for your fish, so you don't need as much medicine into the fish. They stabilize the biological balance, the whole system, all connecting to each other. The plant is the key to the function of your aquarium. It will prevent the algae to grow in your aquarium. They will produce the O2 that the fish and the shrimps will need in your aquarium. But the plants also look good and give shelter for young fish and shrimps. And can you use every plant? No. Only real aquatic plants will survive. You got a lot of swamp plants that are used to be found in places where rivers get an overflow, and it will stay on the water for 2-3 months maximum, and then the water disappears again. If you leave those plants inside of the aquarium, after half a year, they will die, just because they cannot get the transformation to the underwater stage in the aquarium. In every start phase of the aquarium, you're going to need fast-growing plants, because they're going to take in more nutrition for you. You can skip them later on. After half a year, your aquarium is in balance. You can slightly remove the fast growers for other species of plants. How much plants do we need in an aquarium? To get a good balance, you should cover up 60 to 70% of the ground floor with plants. With fast-growing plants, 25% of those 60-70%. Why are the in vitro plants so good? The in vitro plants, most normal plants that we buy here in the shops, are brought up in the greenhouses immersed, meaning in the above water stage. Why do we do that? Because the leaf is hard and strong, so it can survive the transport from the greenhouses to the shops and from the shops to the end consumer. But putting that plant below water, it's going to transform from immerse to submerse to the underwater stage, and it gets a complete new leaf. The leaf, from being very hard, is going to get very soft, and with that leaf it's going to filter the water into the aquarium and takes nutrition out of the water. If we bring plants in that stage already into the shops, most likely a lot of those plants already be damaged before they come into your aquarium. And a damaged plant is a sick plant and will not survive those first weeks in your aquarium. So with those in vitro plants, the plants are already submersed. So you put them into the aquarium and right away they started taking in all the nutrition. They don't have to transform anymore into the aquarium. That's a huge advantage. Also, it's value for your money, those in vitro cups, because we can get much more plants inside a small cup than we can get in normal potted plants. We're all restricted to 6, maybe 7 stems of plants inside of a potted plant. With in vitro, it can go up to 20, 25. With plants transforming from immersed to submersed, they get a whole new leaf. Some plants change color from being green when you bought them, turning red into your aquarium. On every shield that's on a Delaware plant, we will show you the plant submersed. So the shield inside of the plant can have a totally different picture than the plants inside of the cup. We just want you to know that if you fall in love with a green plant and you want to keep green plant in your aquarium, it's going to turn red. Still a beautiful plant, but it's not the green plant that you wanted. In vitro plants are the same aquarium plants as the potted plants. They just have a few advantages. They come in clear markings of medium, easy, and advanced. So you know, as starter in the hobby, or maybe you're already advanced in the hobby, which plants you can handle in your aquarium. I have a small video about the aquarium plants I want to show you, the in vitros. Everybody do something for themselves. And
just a quick poll. How many of you guys have freshwater planting tanks already? And beginner or had them for a while?
Beginner.
Ask the question, how many are successful?
That was my next question.
Volgens Damon, Value Plant came in 8 years ago. It's now top seller number one in our greenhouse. People always complain about snails appearing in their aquariums. But in vitro, cannot happen. We try to give as much information as possible on the little sign on the plant. And most important there, the needed amount of CO2. And it's easy to use. Just wash away the gel. And if there's some gel left on the plant, it's no problem.
What is the gel exactly?
It's a nutrition-based gel, but what's inside is even for me. I've been working for the company almost 15 years now, but still they don't trust me. That's what they call need-to-know base. I don't need to know. But if you can see the volume that comes out of one cup, Ziggy has a show aquarium displayed here, Denon and Nanocube, and he only used 3 potted plants. And if you look later on at that aquarium, how much volume of plants is inside, it's beautiful. This is also a mystery why the second guy sitting over there. I think we pay him. He's got a green shirt on, but that's the job I'm looking for.
He's an arm model.
End model, yeah. This is how quickly in vitro plants built Romeo and Warrior.
Do you label them as foreground, mid-ground, or background on the cup?
Yes. This is the balance after 4 weeks. You put in your mono shrimps, there's nice cleaners. They will help you to get some algae that always will appear in an aquarium cleaned up. Oh, this is also important. The hands of Stefan. You ask yourself, who is Stefan? Stefan is the guy who takes care of our plants and greenhouses. He's very familiar. He also goes into nature. What Ludwig Denner used to do in the 60s is he doing now, and travels all around the world looking for different species of plants. Last year they went to India and came back with some beautiful new plants that turn orange into your aquarium. That's a color that we do not have in the moment. So we're working now, tissue culture based, to get those plants into the market and get enough volume to get it selling. So it's all lab work, it's a lot of work, because it needs some time to grow into the cups. It's all sterile. Cryptocurrene is a very nice plant that we do a lot of in tissue culture. At the moment we have 34 different kind of plants, and it's still growing. I think at this moment we're up to 40, and not every week, but every few months there's a new plant coming into the in vitro assortment. All plants are labeled for foreground, middle, or in the back. They're labeled easy, medium, or hard. This is also a unicum. You can only get this plant through Denneland. This is the Crypto Flamingo. This one stays pink below water. And if you imagine yourself with the Monte Carlo being brightly green and then having a nice street of pink plants next to it, really, really stands out. This plant we came on by accident. It appeared in one of our greenhouses. Came out of a normal crypto, the Wenti, and it had a pink top inside. All of our greenhouses went crazy. All the plant lovers went bizarre. They cut it, tried to pot it like we do normally with our plants in the substrate, and tried to grow it like to a mother plant. Didn't work. Died after 4 weeks. Unfortunately, or luckily, a few months later, another pink top appeared in one of the plants. They took it out and they brought it to the laboratory. And in vitro, we were able to grow the plant and let it stay pink below the water surface. That's really a unicum.
Any special type of water additives to keep that color iron?
No, it's as easy as a normal crypto, and that's the beauty of this plant. It's also labeled easy, because everyone can set this plant into the aquarium. When I do the aquascaping, this is always the center plant for me, because it's one of the plants I've fallen in love with.
Does it grow fast?
Not really fast, but it's not a slow grow like the Anubia family. Those are really slow growing plants, but the crypto, it grows normally. The Urticularia is also a plant that, if you can find it, pot it. It's a real pain in the ass to get it into the aquarium, because they're all single individual plants, and this, the moment you take them out of the pot, you lose half of them. With those gel based, leaving a little bit of gel inside of those plants, you can cut it up in 4, 8, 6 pieces, and it's easier to plant. And immediately in the soil, it starts growing. This is a plant that normally in a normal aquarium, you really have to be a good hobbyist to let it grow. With the in vitro in the soil, it's available for anyone.
Is that dwarf hairgrass?
Yeah. plant, Butch of Anantra, the mini leaf. The Butch of Anantra is a plant that already existed in the market. This one stays very, very small. It's also only available in vitro. And this is a plant that's from the Anubia family. So it's a very slow moving plant in your aquarium.
Was the Busa philandra recently added to your guys' lineup for in vitro?
No, we had it already for maybe 2-3 years. But the mini leaf, that's a really new one. And the newest addition in vitro is the pangolino. It's the smallest Anubia in the world, with leaves not getting bigger than 2-3 millimeters. This plant we're going to use later on in the aquascape. This is going to form the leaf roof of the branches I have set it up. We're going to glue it onto the wood so it's nice and sticky. My hands are a little bit shaky. I'm not good with tying up ropes around plants and tying those little knots. So we use aquascaping glue. It's safe for fish, for shrimps, for everything. I've got a new glue with me that will stay brown below water. So if you put it on the dark side of wood, it doesn't stick out. If you've planted your aquarium with all the plants, you're coming to a critical stage getting into the hobby, because you have to fill your aquarium. Fill it with hot, warm water. Not too hot, not too cold. Plants don't like to be scared of cold water. And fill it in slowly. That water runs into a plate. I always use paper towels to cover my plants, my aquascape. And then I put a plastic bag on top and just let the water slowly run into your aquarium. If you don't do it slow, you're going to ruin your whole aquascape. If you're using substrate and gravel and you pour in a bucket of water, you might as well just get everything out again, because if the substrate comes above the gravel, there's no saving anymore. You cannot do it. We cannot help you anymore. This you're done. So that's what we say to people: go slow. Getting the water into the aquarium. You made it so far, just get an extra few hours, just let dripping in the water, and don't ruin anything. The plants will also need fertilization for the leaves. If you don't put in fertilization into the water, plants will show you that there's a lack of some nutrition into the water. The most easy one to recognize is lack of iron. If plants turn yellow, leaves turn a little bit pale, the plant is screaming for iron into your aquarium. And normal tap water doesn't have any iron inside anymore. This is what a plant needs throughout 30 days. And all those nutritions have to be in a certain level towards each other. So you cannot put from one element a whole bunch in and expecting your plants to grow. It all has to be in balance. It's called the Redfield ratio. Everything in line to each other. You can figure it out on the internet, and you can buy all those nutritions singly and mix 0.000 something with 0.000 something mix up, or you take fertilization that's already balanced out. But the plants, you have to feed them, otherwise they're gonna die. Just the root system takes up the nutrition out of the substrate. We've got all different kinds of fertilization. If you're new, starter in the hobby, we got an easy one. It's called Plant Elixir. It's got the balance of everything that we showed you inside, but not concentrated. So everyone can work with this. We've got the advanced fertilization, that those are three different kinds of fertilization you put into the aquarium. And we got the aquascapers fertilization, and that's a very concentrated fertilization, not to be used by starters in the hobby. That's really special for aquariums that don't have any fish inside, that don't have much shrimps inside, so not a lot of food comes in, not a lot of waste in your aquarium, so you're going to need extra nitrates, extra phosphate into your aquarium. It's weekly fertilization, the plant elixir. Put in once a week and the plants will find everything that they need. If you want to do it daily, no problem. Just divide what you're putting in once a week to 7 and you're good to go. And your plants will find everything that they need to start growing. The most beautiful fertilization is the three-way system. It's S7, E15, and V30. Two of those you put in once a month, and one you put in every week. That's why it's called S7, every 7 days, and 15 days a month, V30, the 30th day of the month. It's a complete fertilization, more concentrated than the plant elixir, so you don't need as much of it to put into your aquarium. Comes with a nice dosage pump. One pump for 50 liters, it's almost 20 gallons of water. And this one you put in once a month. Plants will recognize the fertilization into the aquarium and will start storing it up inside of them and using it throughout those 30 days. Then we got iron. Iron is one of the nutrients we cannot put in liquid. Because iron is only available for plants in one stage. If you look at the iron molecule, this is the most common way we find iron into the aquarium. It's got three oxygen atoms onto it, and it's not available for the plant. First, bacteria have to go to it, take away one of the oxygen atoms, making two early iron, and that's available for plants. If we put iron in the liquid form into the aquarium, we're always bringing in oxygen with it. So that's why the iron fertilization is in tablet form. They're all singly packed, because if you go with wet fingers onto the iron tablets, they will start oxidizing. And this is too early iron. If you put this into the aquarium, the plants will immediately get hold of it. Those are big tablets. We recommend them to throw them just into the aquarium, throw them behind the plant. If you have really big fish in your aquarium, then put them into the filter. Because small fish will come to it, will taste it, and think, not my cup of tea, and swim away. Big cichlids or other big fish, they will think, they come over, swallow it, and then think, ooh, this was not for me. And they have a really hard time digesting it. So if you have big fish, throw it into the filter. And you will see that slowly throughout the month, that iron tablet gets smaller and smaller and smaller. And then you're running your aquarium for a year, year and a half, and then after a month you see that the tablet is still there, or parts of it still there. That is your sign. I've got enough iron into my aquarium, so this month I'll skip it. And the balance is already set into the aquarium. But if your plants are yellow, screaming for iron, because they cannot get the photosynthetic into the plants.
Can you put the tablet in the substrate, buried a little bit, or no?
No, it has to be available floating into the water.
It's mainly for the leaves.
It's a leaf fertilization.
Yeah.
It's the only We're talking now only about leaf fertilization. The plant has transformed himself from immersed to submerged. The leaves are very pale and very soft, so the water goes through it, and he's filtering the water with nutrition. But we have to make sure that all the nutrition is there. And without iron, the photosynthetic process will not start then, because the plant is ill. It's not feeling well at the moment. And then we have a nutrition, it's called S7. This one we put in every week. These are the vitamins. These are your oranges, your apples, your bananas, your whatever we eat to get our vitamins and stay healthy. There are also vitamins for your fish. With using S7, you will see that your fish are much healthier, stronger, not so stressful into your aquarium. With using those three fertilization, you're closing the whole food surplus for those plants. They can find everything in a right balance towards each other in your aquarium. But if you really want to do it good, because we're bringing in fertilization for a whole month in your aquarium, so we're always having a high on nutrition, and we're going to have a low on nutrition in the aquarium. That's why we came in with the dosator. It's a powerless piece of plastic. It has a membrane. Looks like a small piece of paper. You can pass it around. And this paper is semi-permeable, meaning water can go through, but cannot get out anymore. This dosator we fill up with V30, S7. Those fertilizations have a color. One is green, the other one is orange. It's going to be shown inside of your dosator. You push the top part down a little bit until the fertilization is almost ready to get out. And then you just stick it into your aquarium. The water goes through the membrane and starts pushing, drop by drop, fertilization into the water. So every day, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, fertilization is coming in, drop by drop, into your aquarium. Without any power, just doing Mother Nature's work. And then you're away from your highs and your low in the fertilization.
What size aquarium would that one would you do?
This one goes up to, sorry, to 100 gallon.
Uh-huh.
Yep. Got the measuring on it. I will pass this one around too. Got the measuring in liters onto it, but in the user manual it's all in gallons translated, so it's easy to use.
So in the chart down at the bottom, are you saying that this is what he's holding there creates the green line with the blue bar?
Yep.
And that it's like a shorter, stabler thing than the big wavy?
Yes.
Got it. All right.
Yes.
Thanks.
It also comes with stickers, and those stickers you're going to put on the membrane depending on the size of the aquarium that you have. The bigger your aquarium, the bigger a hole is going to be in the sticker. So more water can go through into the dosator, the faster the fertilization comes out. All depending on the size of your aquarium. Figuring this piece of paper out took us 6 years. The idea was very quickly there. It had to be powerless, had to be for cleaning the plastic. But this, getting the right amount of fertilization into each of the aquarium, that was the hard one. But we managed it, and it's working perfectly. Yes.
You put back the vise at the top of the water with that little piece sticking out.
Yes.
Yeah.
you put it
down
too deep, and you
right.
there's water coming in, and
you want it somewhere that there's not a lot of water flow.
Water flow is not the problem, because the drug will come in. We recommend it in a closed aquarium, not to put it too near to the light, because if it's too near to the light is going to give out so much heat that the fertilization before it goes into the aquarium is already dried up. So just put it a little bit on the side and let it drop. If you have a rimless aquarium.
So even if you have water flow too, that piece of paper will only allow X amount to go through.
Yes.
So actually you would want the water flow.
We need water flow
okay.
to
okay.
get the nutrition going around and around in your aquarium. So you need a certain amount of water flow.
Right.
What you don't need with your water flow is getting it into the aquarium with oxygen. Because we always want it below the water surface. Because otherwise we bring in too much oxygen. Looking at iron, we're going to make the iron that's available in the aquarium immediately unavailable for the plants. So, but we need some water flow to get it around in the aquarium. This is a picture of how it should look in your aquarium, and you can clearly see that there's fertilization still in the dosator. It's almost up to the top, and here you see the water surface. So water cannot get into the dosator mixing up with the fertilization. And if this fertilization, if the liquid inside is as clear as your aquarium, you have to redose. So drop by drop, 24/7. The indicator by the coloring of the fertilization. Oh, no, no, that's good. How long does the membrane last? As long as you don't poke a hole in it, or it's covered with dirt, or water is not allowed anymore inside, then you have to get a new membrane on. But with every dose that you buy, you get free membrane. So it's going to last for a long time. And can you use it for other liquidation, fertilization from other brands? Yes, but we're not going to guarantee you how much fertilization comes into your aquarium. It's all based on the Daneler fertilization.
So do you use that with the advanced stuff, or if you wanted that elixir stuff, you're saying you put the elixir in there too, and then
yes.
the point is that it meters it out, whatever you're putting in.
You have to look inside the user manual, which sticker that you have to put onto your membrane then. Depending on which fertilization you're using and which size aquarium that you have. Last year there was a big convention in Germany, in Nuremberg, in the Interzoo Court, and we won an innovation prize with this dosator. Being powerless, being so easy to use, the idea is so simple, but somebody has to produce it and get it into the market.
Between 6 months and a year.
Okay.
But again, if you punch a hole in it.
Oh, sure, yeah, but there's some products that they sell, and then next thing you know, they like, you know, they want you to buy something like every week in order.
That's what we're going to do, but
yeah.
According to the German stuff, it always lasts a long, long time. The quality is good too.
It's like balancing out.
Yeah.
Just like the fish tank.
And then you get your scapeless fertilization, the silver bottles. Those we don't recommend for people starting in the hobby. Those are highly concentrated fertilization with aquariums with lots of CO2, lots of difficult plants, lots of light coming onto the aquarium, not enough fish inside. So if you overdose this one, you get into trouble. You get clean water. Then you have to help your plants by doing lots of water change to set the balance again. But it's a weekly fertilization. You can use it up to also daily fertilization. And if you use the nosator, it goes automatically. Then we have almost all the nutrition that the plants need into the aquarium. But the most important one, CO2. For the photosynthetic process, the plant needs three things: light, water, carbon. If one of those three is not enough available in your living environment, there will not be photosynthetic in your aquarium, meaning your plants will stop growing. The light, the CO2, the sugars, the O2 as waste, and for us, vital. Also in the aquarium. People ask me, is it possible without? Everything is possible, but it's not recommendable. You will see the difference in an aquarium, freshwater aquarium, with or without CO2. In 2 weeks' time, you have a completely different aquarium. Your plants will be much healthier, much bigger, much stronger. You have to cut them several times already. And without CO2, the plant is only getting the CO2 that the fish and the bacteria give into the water. Because in our tap water, there is no CO2 anymore. If you look at nature again, the areas where plants are growing, there is a lot of CO2 into the water. It's the basic of all plant life. I would go one step farther. It's the basic of all life on Earth. Without oxygen, no one would survive over here. The plant is 50% carbon. If we want the plant to grow, we should give him also that building stone, the carbon inside of the aquarium. If you look at CO2, it dissolves into the water in carbon and in dioxide. The dioxide part will lower your pH level. And the carbon has been taken in by the plant to start growing and starting the photosynthetic process. We can put in the carbon liquid. But it's always better to use CO2. But this product will provide the carbon needed for your aquarium plants. If you're scared of CO2 or think it's too chemical or too difficult, use the liquid carbon. There is not such a thing as liquid CO2. CO2 is always a gas. But the liquid carbon will provide the plants the building stone into the aquarium. And also, this one we can use inside of the dosator, because we have to put it in every day.
the plant's gonna need the carbon every day for this photosynthesis process.
So you have several dosators with several liquid fertilizer.
That's what we noticed too.
You can't mix them all together?
Some of them you can mix together. The V30 with the liquid carbon, so that's your basic fertilization with the carbon fertilization, you can mix already together. And we're trying to develop more and more and more so that you don't have your whole aquarium covered up with those things. That's not what we want. Next to the liquid carbon, can you produce your own CO2 by adding sugar and yeast together? Like baking bread or rice, it's the same process going on with sugar and yeast. If you do that at home in a Coca-Cola bottle, it's easy to do. But the amount of CO2 you're bringing into your aquarium, you don't know. Because when that process started, it's gonna give those bubbles of CO2 and they keep coming and keep coming and keep coming. So maybe for your aquarium it's too much, maybe it's not enough for your aquarium. We've got a bio-CO2 that's working on the basis of sugar and yeast, and it will produce 300,000 bubbles of CO2, lasting 30 days. So with the bio-CO2, you're getting a certain amount of level of CO2 for 30 days into your aquarium, and it's gone. And it's very easy to use. You fill up the bottle with water, tap water, not aquarium water, because aquarium water has too much bacteria already inside, and they will fight the yeast process for you. That's not what we want. So tap water, all the way up to the arrow. Inside, there's a little capsule. You open that one up, throw it inside, throw the shell also in, turn the lid on. On the other side, put the hose on, the CO2 hose, and the other end goes into the diffuser, or what we do with this one. If you have the escapers tank or the shrimp tank, you can connect it to your filter, so you don't have an extra diffuser into your aquarium. And this will produce 30 days of CO2 in your aquarium, because there's gel inside is so concentrated and made that it will produce those 300,000 bubbles of CO2 in your aquarium.
Somebody actually counted 300,000?
There is someone
who actually counted.
Yes. No, I didn't want that joke either. No. No. But that's the easiest way of bringing CO2 into your aquarium. It comes with a small container. I had to take it out, but this small container, you put the bottle inside and stick it to the aquarium. Why? The warmer it gets, the better the CO2 will come out. If you put it in below in the cabinet, it's colder over there and it's more difficult, takes longer time to get activated. If you stick it to the aquarium, within 24 hours you will see bubbles of CO2 coming into the aquarium. And this is the nicest way to get started with CO2. Because it's so controlled, you never can go wrong. It's never going to overdose the CO2 level in your aquarium, but you will see the effect that it has on your plant. This goes up to aquariums 10, 15 gallons. But even in a bigger tank, you will see results. Because first there was no CO2, and now there's a certain amount, the level of CO2. It's not the level that the plants want, but
but you will see the reaction on the plant. And there's nothing more beautiful in an aquarium than in the afternoon, that you see all those little air bubbles coming out of the plants. That's for you, the signal for my aquarium is in balance. The plants are happy, the plants are producing the photosynthetic, they are taking in the waste out of the aquarium and providing my fish and shrimps with the oxygen they need.
If you bought that pot, you still need to get a diffuser.
If you have our escaper tank, or you have an aquarium with this corner filter, you can attach it to it. The outgoing from the filter, here goes the hose of the CO2 on, this goes in between, and the water with the CO2 comes into the aquarium. But important, not above, but below the water surface. Because if you let it come in an angle, a lot of your CO2 is already gone. The more water movement that you have in your aquarium, the more CO2 you reject out of the aquarium. How much CO2 do we need into an aquarium? We need between the 10 and 30 milligrams of CO2 per liter, so that's 1/3 of a gallon, in your aquarium to be the optimum for your plants. But every aquarium has a different need of CO2, depending on the temperature, depending on the plants inside, depending on how much light you have onto your aquarium. The basic rule is 10 to 30 milligrams CO2. And then you have pressured gas bottles with CO2. It's got a regulator on top so you can adjust it just the way that's needed for your aquarium. With every set comes a CO2 test. The test contains a liquid. We're going to show it later on at the Aquascape Aquarium. It's a liquid that's blue inside of the bottle. But you put it into the holder goes into the aquarium, and the liquid will react on the CO2 into your aquarium. And the liquid will turn from blue to yellow. Blue meaning no CO2 in your water, yellow meaning too much CO2 in your water. If you mix those two colors up, you get green. And if it's in green level, it's good. So by walking into your room, or wherever your aquarium is, looking at your CO2 indicator, you're knowing the situation in your aquarium. Roughly you can tell your pH level. Roughly you can say, okay, my plants have enough CO2 to start the photosynthetic process. So you see if your aquarium is in balance. This is nice for nano aquarium, so smaller ones, up to 20 gallons. And then we get the bigger sets. Same regulator, adjustable for the amount of CO2 that you want into your aquarium. Also with the CO2 test, this one comes with a free pack of fertilization for your plants. And this go up to, this is 100 gallon, but we can go up to 200-300 gallon. And what changes then? It changes, we call it the flipper. It's a little stair. And the bubble goes from left to right, upwards. And the longer the bubble is moving inside of the water, the more CO2 it will give on to the water. So the more water you can fertilize with your CO2. If we look at diffusers, the CO2 comes in, gets pressed through the membrane, and then goes upwards. And that's the way that the CO2 has been taken in by the aquarium. Every bubble that you see coming up to the surface has no use. It pops open and is
in the room. So the longer we can trap that bubble of CO2 into the aquarium and let it stay in contact with the water, the more fertilization we get into the aquarium. So with this set, you have a normal flipper. In the big tank over there, we have the maxi one. So it's bigger, so the bubble has a longer way to travel into the aquarium. Questions about CO2 fertilization? Nice. Everyone has CO2 on the aquarium? Why not? So next week, CO2. You see a completely different aquarium. And then light. Light onto the aquarium. Light has two purposes. First, we're going to see into the aquarium, but it also has to support the photosynthetic process in the aquarium. Without light, there is no photosynthetic process going on. With too much light into an aquarium, will bring you algae growth. Because the plant cannot take it in. The more light, the more CO2, the more fertilization you need in to your aquarium. It's all about the balance. We have looked at Mother Nature again, for which spectrum does the plant need into the aquarium. And it's been shown that plants have no use for blue or violet in the photosynthesis process. So bringing those two into the aquarium will certainly give you algae growth. Because you're bringing in nutrition that the plant cannot take in into the aquarium. So it's very important to look at the light that you're buying, that it has the spectrum into the green, the yellow, and into the red. That you get the Kelvin from 6,000 to 7,000 into your aquarium. Otherwise, we're going into this section, and this is beautiful for marine life, but it's nothing for freshwater. Light should be onto an aquarium for maximum 10 hours. Better is 8. And with those 8 hours, it's even better to bring in a pause from 2 hours into your aquarium. Give them 4 hours of lighting, 2 hours out, 4 hours of lighting. The photosynthetic process keeps on going on. If you make a pause longer than 3 hours, then a plant will start thinking, must be nighttime. And then it shuts off its whole photosynthetic process and goes into the night stage. But keeping that pause around 2 hours will prevent algae to grow. Algae are only used for one kind of light. Doesn't matter what spectrum it is, but it has to be constant. If we cut it in half, we save power, and we're doing something good for your aquarium. Most of the times we're at work during the day, so the pause in the middle doesn't bother us, and for the plants, it's the optimum. With our small LED lighting, we get the spectrum from 6,500 Kelvin. It goes in 30 centimeters. Ziggy, you can help me now with how many inches that is.
How many of what? How many?
30 centimeters.
30 centimeters? 12 inches, isn't it?
No.
2.5. Yeah.
You've got 20,000 operating hours, meaning the feeding light, the 6,500 Kelvin, will come up in 20,000 hours. That light will not lose power into your aquarium. Normal tube lighting, especially the cheaper ones, T5 or T8 lighting, will go down into the Kelvins after half a year. Optimum, we're still seeing light, but the plants are really having problems getting that photosynthetic process started on the lack of light coming into the water. With LED, you're much safer over there. It's a nice design, doesn't stick out, doesn't take away the beauty of your aquarium. The water. These products are not available at the moment in the US from Danilor, but they are there from different brands. Make sure that if you're using tap water, that you get out all the chemicals, all the hard irons, copper or other irons that may be inside the water. Make sure your fish are happy in the water they swim in. Bacteria. You should put bacteria into the aquarium every week, because those are the little helpers in your aquarium. Bacteria will reproduce themselves into the aquarium. But we are polluting the aquarium way faster than the bacteria can reproduce and keep up with the waste that comes into the aquarium. And that comes again with the food that comes in too much into the aquarium. You also had to have a buffer of hardness in your aquarium. From 2 to 4 is ideal. And if you're using RO water, you should add minerals and hardness to the water. Your pH level should always be around 6.8, 6.9, just to prevent algae growing in your aquarium. Water change, at least 25 to 50% every 2 weeks. And the more is better. If we're only taking out 25% of the water that we polluted, then 75% stays behind. The 25% fresh water that we bring in will not bring a whole big difference in the 75% that you polluted. So over the 50% will really change your water condition in your aquarium. Prepare the water to the standards that you need. If you use tap water, and the tap water is with a hardness or a pH level way above, use RO water. RO water is everywhere the same in the world. You can build it up to the standard that you and your aquarium fish want. And use the bacteria every week. They will help you. They will help you fight against the algae. Water filtration. This is a small corner filter from Danilor that comes with the scapers tank and the shrimp tank. It's already inside. It's a beautiful small filter, especially made for keeping shrimps in your aquarium, because the filter cartridge is right up to the intake of the water, so shrimps cannot get in. Comes with the outflow, cleaning brush, complete set. Those tanks are specially made for shrimps. You will not see fish pictures on the layouts, just because it's not allowed in Germany to put fish inside of tanks below the 20 gallons. It's the law. But we know people take them home and they will put fish inside of those tanks. That small corner filter is specially developed for shrimps, and the pollution the shrimps will bring into the water. So if we add fish into the tank and we start feeding them, because we like to feed our fish, but we like to show them in the upper surface of the aquarium, the water gets more polluted. Then you have an extension, you click it on to the filter, you can fill it up with biological material, and it has a larger surface of bacteria grow inside. So you get more bacteria breaking down the waste in your aquarium. And then the fish and animals. They are also part of the ecosystem in your aquarium. They are part of the balance in your aquarium. And you have to feed them, we know. But please feed them with the best food you can find. We're all trying to eat healthy ourselves. Bless you. We all are feeding our dogs and cats the best food that we can find within our aquarium. We most likely to throw in the cheapest food that we can find. And that food has no nutrition value. If you look at the backside, the ingredients of that food, and if there stays fish meal or fish bones, fish products, means they get all the waste from the places where they fillet the fish and the heads, the tails, the bones, everything goes into the grinder and it costs nothing. And that's how we make our food. So look at the backside of the food that you're giving at the moment into your aquarium. Make sure that it hasn't had any fillers inside. Choose your fish wisely on the size of the tank. We have seen pictures of beautiful discus fish. But if the beautiful discus fish are in the 10-gallon tank, you're not making them happy. And below 10 gallons, make sure you use shrimps. There's so many beautiful shrimps available at the moment. And if you choose fish, choose the little ones, the Rasbora Galaxy. One of the most beautiful nylon fish. And in a small tank, you will see them perfectly. You can take the most beautiful pictures of them. The denim foods, even the shrimp foods, I will show you around. You can look at the backside of the ingredients. There are no fillers inside. The production process that we have preserves all the vitamins inside of the food. And if the food that comes into your fish is from good quality, your fish is going to be healthier. So you don't stress them out too much. They don't get sick as much. Real handwork, made in Germany, it's not handmade. It's made by a machine. The complete food is the one you need at the moment that you have shrimps inside of your aquarium. It's the basic food. Covers everything that the shrimps will need. And also with shrimps, it's important not to overfeed them. If you put one or two sticks in and they lay there for all day, that's more than enough. You don't have to feed them the next day then. And if you feed them once every 2 days. Let them go out and search for the food. Let them show their natural behavior. Because shrimps and fish creature of habit, the moment you walk up to the aquarium, they will show up because you're going to throw something in, they know. With shrimps, you need to add minerals into the water. If shrimps start growing, they're throwing off their armor, getting new armor. That twitching stage is very, very important for the shrimps. Then they are very vulnerable. By adding the minerals into the food, you're helping them with that process. And again, no fish meal. Proteins. You need proteins in your aquarium. Why? I tell you. The shrimps are the little rabbits of your aquarium. You put in 10, and a few weeks later, you have 15, 20. A few weeks later, you have 30, 40. They keep on going. And that's the beauty of shrimps in your aquarium. With the proteins, you make sure that the eggs are from good quality, that they can hatch very good. And then you get your babies into the aquarium, and you have to take care of them. So that's also a food with adrenal. It's water stable, so it doesn't go into dust, doesn't sink into the substrate, and those baby shrimps, they will find it. It will go to the bottom, and they will scratch it and search for it. With those baby shrimps and the shrimp tank, you can click on the baby protect onto the filter. The cartridge is right up to the filter. but those lawns are so small, they can get stuck in between. And we don't want that. So with the baby protect, we make sure that even the filter is safe for the smallest one in your aquarium. And then we have snow pops. This makes it possible for you to feed your shrimps at one area and hold on to them. It's like popcorn. You throw it as a fast stick into your aquarium and it reaches the bottom, lays there for 10 seconds and pops open. So you get a large surface of shrimp feeding. If you put sticks in, the biggest shrimp will get the most food. And with popping it open, you allow the shrimps to eat more. But this is a snack. This is not your basic food. This is one if you want to show off to friends or family, come over and look at how many shrimps I have in my aquarium. You throw it in and they'll come out. For shrimps, we recommend RO water. Shrimps are very sensible for water change. So bringing up your RO water with results to the right standards that you need, then everybody can be successful in holding freshwater shrimps. The different kind of shrimps, this is the difficult ones, the Cardinale Denali. This shrimp is found in Sulawesi. We found it in 2006, 2007. And this is the most difficult shrimp to hold into your aquarium. Because it's very sensible for water change, has to be a high temperature water. But with this bee salt, you're even able to keep these shrimps alive and let them reproduce in your nano aquarium. And if you can find them, you should buy them. They're expensive. I know I paid 4 years ago, I paid $25 each of the shrimps that we didn't have the salt. And I enjoyed them for 3-4 months, and then suddenly they all died. Now with the salts, I'm able to keep them alive for over a year. And in that year, they will reproduce themselves, so you get a nice, stable colony of shrimps inside of your aquarium. Algae will always come in every aquarium, especially in the start phase of every aquarium. It's up to us to decide what to do with it. Look for the source of the algae. Look why it's appearing. Is your water conditions, the pH level too high, light, too much light, the wrong light, sunlight coming into your aquarium, the wrong plants you've used. Maybe you've used 60% of the Anubia family. And they want to grow, but they're not growing that fast. So they're not taking out all the nutrition out of your water. Do you have too much fish? Yes, everyone has too much fish. But too much food and the wrong kind of food into your aquarium. Maybe you don't have any CO2 in your aquarium, so the plants cannot do the job that they needed to do in your aquarium. Finding the answer is solving the problem. But if you have the problem with algae in your aquarium, with that green water, you're not going to change that overnight. Somewhere along the 5 steps, you may wrong left turn or wrong right turn, and you have to get back on track. That's going to take up some time. Doing a water change every 2 days, because algae is always too much nutrition into your water. So with water change, you're helping your aquarium to get rid of the nutrition. But never, please, never use products that will kill algae in your aquarium. They're all based on copper sulfate, and they will kill and destroy everything in your aquarium. Just look at Mother Nature, water current, making sure the balance is set in your aquarium, and you'll be fine. We're going to do the aquascaping life afterwards. Normally we do the hardscape, everything, but the tank was so big that we had to do it last night already, the hardscape, otherwise people would be sitting for 3 hours, me shaving rocks from left to right and complaining about the size of the aquarium, so we did it in size. As you see, aquascaping can also be done by gravel. This is not soil, but by substrate, and they cover it up with gravel. This is Jochen Filker. He works for Danilev, and he's one of the hotshots on aquascaping level. He became world champion this year in Markenberg in February in the Big Tank competition. So very glad that we have him on board and helping us out with the aquascaping. And aquascaping, everyone can do it. The rules of Mother Nature doesn't change. So follow the system, follow and get your balance into your aquarium. But with aquascaping, if you want to do rocks, if you want to do stones, if you have a weird kind of picture in your mind that you want to build, if the end result is what you want it to be, you aquascape. Maybe not as in the big leagues, but you aquascape. You have to look at it. He works a lot with mops in between the stones. And if you go up high in the back of an aquarium and you're using substrate and gravel, make sure that the plant can get in every stage of its growth, find his nutrition. So you don't put in a big ball of substrate and then cover it up with a little bit of gravel, because it's going to cost you a lot. Just get some substrate, gravel, and build in steps for the plant. So at every stage of the plant, you will find its nutrition. You had a question? Or?
Yeah, I'm curious your opinion, because I've heard people who swear by only buying hardscape materials from a store, and people who swear by only like going into the woods and finding sticks and rocks. And I just like,
yeah.
You if, know, if I don't you, know if, who to believe.
If you buy it in the store, you're sure that nobody feeds over it. not even being a person, but maybe a bear or a pig, or you don't know what's happened. And if you buy it in the stores, it's all been cleaned, it's all been guaranteed, it's free from any kind of disease, any kind of chemicals onto it. I would go always for buying it in shops. That being said, we had an aquascaper, the Shrimp King, and he told us about freshwater shrimps, and he likes to collect his stones into nature. And we had a show in Vegas, and he went out into the desert collecting black rocks that he saw there, and he came back with, I think, 300 pounds of it, and was carrying them to his car in 105 degrees weather. So if you're into that, yes. I like to go into the shop, especially if you look here what Ziggy has done. He's built a wooden box, so you can take out the stones, you can place them inside, see how they look, change them. I think it's better. Not just for supporting the local shops. The plants, the in vitros, value for your money. Think about them the next time you buy aquarium plants. Different kind of rocks. Dragon rock is my favorite. That's the one I always use. I like the tanks being set up also with freshwater shrimps. They will go in every hole that's in the rock. They'll come everywhere. It's hard to find. If you have a shop that has the right amount of dragonstone, you're lucky. And even the small pieces you're going to use in your aquascape. You're going to build a path with it, or you're going to have them stick out a little bit, like it's, the rock is coming out of the gravel, it's growing on you. Different kind of woods. Make sure if you use spider wood or any kind of wood that you block it with, stones. It's nothing depressing as being almost done with your aquarium and filling it up and your wood start floating. And I speak from experience. Escape is gravel. This is from Denler. I saw some from another brand over here with nice small stones so you can make a path or just light up something. And we're almost at the end. So the aquarium bed, very important in every freshwater planted aquarium. Plants, the right plants, the right fertilization. Don't forget your CO2. It's very important. The right amount of light, good water condition, and then your animals. If all those factors are in balance with each other, you have a crystal clear aquarium. Your fish and shrimps are healthy, and you enjoy a little piece of nature inside of your house. It's like an ever-changing painting. If you have a small nano tank like I do at home, with about 300 shrimps at this moment inside. And shrimps, they are always busy. They're always shipping something from left to right or climbing on. You don't need to have them anymore. It's so relaxing. We got a lot of info material about shrimps, about aquarium plants, about aquascaping. Beautiful, beautiful underwater pictures by Chris Lukhout and Stefan Hummel from the trips that they made throughout the world, and they've been in amazing places looking for aquarium plants. And you can also look us up at www.denler.com. If you have questions about your aquarium, if you run into trouble in your aquarium, just get in contact with us. Send us an email, we come back to you. And we always find a solution for every aquarium. I think that's all I had to say about that. You can have four questions.
When we do a water tank, yes, we add salt.
Salt?
Will that affect the tank?
Yeah. And why do you add salt?
That was like an old aquarium trick that I heard as a kid too.
What does salt do? Salt will get the skin of the fish a little bit stronger and more closed. So parasites have a harder time getting into the fish. But if your aquarium is in balance and you're using the S7 as vitamins, that's already happening to the fish. The skin of the fish is already much more healthier and closed, so you don't need the salt. It's an old trick, but in Europe it's not common anymore.
Okay. Second question.
Yes.
You said I can have four.
Yeah.
You're talking about invert and submerge.
Immerse and submerge. Yeah.
Immerse. Okay.
Yeah.
A lot of the plants I thought were dead, the leaves would be gone, within the first week or two. I put them into another tank, and they seemed to grow different.
Yeah.
And I thought it was just maybe the water change that I did.
No, that's the plant first dying in your aquarium,
right,
and then coming back in a different stage into your aquarium.
I wasted time pulling it out.
Yeah. But if nobody told you that, how should you know?
Never did.
That's why we also do on our potted plants the picture of the plant submerged. Because we had complaints from customers years and years ago that the beautiful green plant that they bought turned red, messed up the whole aquarium. That's why education is part of what we do.
Lunch is being served, but you guys did get a bank night in the book, and then also a skate. It's very important.
And a hat. Good. All the plans are built with that. The pictures. Over 200 species inside. And they've all been shown femurs and succulents. And then where you should put them, where it comes from, how much CO2 that it needs, and in the back, that's maybe the most important spaces. What can you do?
Answer. I want one tank out of 20 that I have from that. I mean, about what?
Not for yourself? Look at that. But that's why we normally do this. We have 50 years here.
I think
the US is on salt water. That's what we all have to learn in Europe. With fresh water, we can actually bring some
of that way.
The less fresh the better it is.